One of the more pointed clashes in last night's debate came between Mayor Pete Buttigieg and former Texas Congressman Beto O'Rourke. This was over O'Rourke's plan for a mandatory buyback of assault weapons.
You just made it clear that you don't know how this is actually going to take weapons off the streets. If you can develop the plan further, I think we can have a debate about it, but we can't wait. People are dying in the streets right now.
Those students who marched for our lives, who in fact came up with this extraordinary, bold peace plan that calls for mandatory buybacks, let's follow their inspiration and lead and not be limited by the polls and the consultants and the focus groups.
The problem isn't the polls. The problem is the policy. And I don't need lessons from you on courage, political or personal.
All right, joining us now is 2020 Democratic presidential candidate Beto O'Rourke. Good morning, Congressman.
Good morning, Alisyn.
Great to have you. So let's dive into that exchange in particular, because it sounded like what Mayor Buttigieg was saying was that your plan was not fleshed out enough. Can you flesh it out more? How do you plan to get assault weapons away from people who don't want to give them up?
It's pretty simple. As with any law in this country, we would expect our fellow Americans to follow the law. It's one of those things that distinguishes us from so much of the rest of the world. We're a nation of laws, and no person is above the law, no matter how much they may disagree with a given law. We also have the precedent of Australia, which took the bold step of having a mandatory buyback of these AR-15s and AK-47s. As you know, weapons that were designed for war, to kill people on a battlefield that have no use for hunting or self-defense in your home, but can kill people at a terrifying rate and terrifying numbers if left in the hands of civilians. And we've seen that in El Paso, in Dayton, in Odessa, throughout this country.
But
this is the right thing to do, and I fully expect my fellow Americans to follow the law.
You expect mass shooters to follow the law?
Our fellow Americans will follow the law, yes.
Congressman, mass shooters don't fall. By definition, the mass shooters in Parkland, in El Paso, I could go on for 10 minutes. They don't follow the law, by definition.
There are so many instances where the proposals that we've made, whether it is a universal background check or a red flag law or ending the sale of weapons of war or buying those that are out there back, would have stopped many of the shootings that we see in a country that loses 40,000 people a year to gun violence. Would it stop every single shooting? No. But that should be no excuse for not taking action now while we have the opportunity to do the right thing.
Yeah.
And we also shouldn't be limited by the politics or the conventional political wisdom or the polling or the consultant class or the NRA taking decisive action.
Understood. And I think that what Mayor Buttigieg was saying, obviously think high, aim, shoot for something aspirational, but it doesn't make sense that people are going to hand over their assault weapons. If they're mass shooters, if they want to do harm to people, they're not going to follow the law. So then what's your plan?
Yeah. So I don't know that you make any law or stop making any law because you fear that some people will not follow the law in any part of American life. And so, yes, if somebody has an assault weapon, a weapon of war, and poses a danger to people in their lives or people in their community or people in our lives, then we're going to stop them. And
meaning what? You're going to go to their house. Just tell us how it works. You're going to go to if somebody doesn't voluntarily hand over their assault weapon, you're going to go to their house, and then what?
If we pass this law, then I expect our fellow Americans to follow the law. And this is not speculation. We've seen other countries do this, like Australia.
Law-abiding people follow the law, but our problem is with mass shooters who don't.
You know, Alisyn, by that logic, we wouldn't commence writing any new legislation or signing anything into law for fear of some people not following the law. So we know, because we've seen this in other countries, that when we take this step, we save the lives of those who would otherwise be taken from these mass shootings. We prevent guns from getting into the wrong hands, and we take them out of the hands of those who shouldn't own them in the first place. And unlike a handgun or a shotgun or a hunting rifle, an AR-15, an AK-47 is materially different. It is a weapon of war designed to kill people on a battlefield. And if we just throw up our hands and say, you know, this is going to be tough to do, or some people aren't going to follow the law, then we consign ourselves and become complicit in the deaths of our fellow Americans. And yeah, after El Paso or Odessa or Dayton or all these mass shootings, I'm not going to become complacent. I'm going to do what might be politically difficult to do.
Understood.
May not be popular in all circles, but is necessary to save lives.
I understand that that's your aspiration. And I think that the question was, and then what? And then what's next? Because it sounds like confiscation. And I just can't tell if you're comfortable with that. You know that that's a buzzword that makes a lot of people on the right and gun owners nervous. And so if that's what you're suggesting.
No, I'm not suggesting that. And I think that's why people use the word confiscation, because it scares people. What I'm talking about is a mandatory buyback, where Americans who own an AR-15 or an AK-47 will sell that weapon back to the government. And there is precedent for doing this in other parts of the world successfully, without infringing upon our fellow Americans' Second Amendment rights to own a firearm that they need for self-defense in their home or to go hunting or for collection or sport. Okay. We can take those weapons that pose a mortal risk to our fellow Americans, instruments of terror that have terrorized our fellow Americans, and for as long as they are out there, strike terror in the hearts of so many, including people going to school right now who are participating in active shooter drills, because we still have these weapons out there. Let's do something about it.
Okay, so Congressman, let's talk about the nuts and bolts of your campaign. So what is next for your campaign?
This Thursday, just outside of Dallas, Texas, we're going to have a rally against fear. At that same time, Donald Trump is going to be in Dallas, Texas. And we know that his message of racism and intolerance, his invitation of violence, which we saw come home to El Paso on August 3rd, must be rejected, and all of us must stand up against it, stand up to be counted, and stand up to describe an America where everyone has a chance to be successful and no one is disqualified or thought to be dangerous based on our differences. So this Thursday at 6 o'clock in Grand Prairie, we're all coming together, Democrats, Republicans, independence for the best values and traditions of this country. It's a great opportunity not only to stand up against Donald Trump, but to stand up for America.
And Congressman, in terms of the longevity of your campaign, what if you don't make the next debate stage? And is money an issue?
You know, we'll have to make that decision when we get there. I fully expect to be able to qualify. I fully expect that the support that we're seeing on the ground as we travel the country will be reflected in the polls that are necessary to qualify. And we've seen some signs for encouragement. Our month-over-month fundraising totals have increased every one of the last 3 months. We raised $1 million more this last quarter than we did the quarter before. Our signups at BetoO'Rourke.com to knock on doors or make phone calls or join this grassroots campaign have increased every single month. So I'm encouraged by what I'm seeing. I'm grateful for all of my fellow Americans who've joined this campaign. And I commit to them to make the most of this moment to bring us together, bring everyone in to the greatest set of challenges that we've ever faced, and to make sure that America overcomes them and that we fully develop the greatness of this country for everyone in this country.
Congressman Beto O'Rourke, we always appreciate having you on New Day. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Alisyn.